Kia ora te whānau, no makey Sunday I tēnei wiki te wiki o te reo Māori ko miri a makamo ahau. More than 1 million people go tramping in Aotearoa every year. Now most return home safe and sound, but for around 500, things don't go to plan, and that's when tramping can be dangerous. In July, in the middle of winter, John Tame found himself lost, alone and badly injured in the middle of Nelson's Kahurangi National Park. His is an incredible story of survival against the odds. Here's Mark Kreisel.
Get a bit drier still, do you think?
Yeah, I do.
Keep it up the water.
There's no such thing as an ordinary person.
John Tame is my name.
But there are ordinary, extraordinary tales of survival.
You're the guy who got lost?
I did, for my sins.
Oh, that's really hard to control it.
And this is one of them.
Pack aside. Clear forward.
Should he buy a lotto ticket?
Oh, you should buy two. You should buy two.
Mostly, life's run-of-the-mill for John and Linda Tame.
That, garlic, please.
John's 69, an accountant by trade. Linda, a high school principal.
Because I've got all of those meetings this week from school.
They met for the first time in 1979.
Yeah. I wouldn't say it was love at first sight, but it was pretty close to that.
Really?
And we've been together ever since, yeah.
Their four fully grown kids have flown the nest, leaving Linda and John to happily make the most of beautiful Golden Bay, 2 hours west of Nelson.
Well, the Boulder Lake track is relatively close.
And this is where our tale begins.
So Linda was away?
Yes, she was away on business in Auckland. So, yeah, it was opportunistic.
Boulder Lake track is in the middle of our second largest national park, Kahurangi.
There are a few tramps nearby that are on the bucket list that really I thought, well, I'll have a crack at some of these and get them out of the way.
According to the DOC website, it's an 8 to 10 hour tramp to the Boulder Lake hut. Difficulty hard. John loaded up his pack.
So this is all the stuff you took up, mate?
It's all of it. Enough food for a couple of days, easily. I had two jackets, waterproof gloves. I had a sleeping bag, a headlight, and I had a map.
He drove 20 minutes to the start of the track and signed into the visitor's book.
What was the most important thing you took?
It was a personal locator beacon, absolutely, for which I paid the paltry sum of $20 for the weekend to hire.
It was noon on Friday. He planned to spend a night at the hut and be back by Saturday afternoon.
I headed off at midday, which was later than I originally intended, and that's where I made a bad mistake.
Remember, it was an 8 to 10 hour tramp to the hut. In 5 hours, it would be dark.
Were you prepared to be walking, say, through 3 or 4 hours of darkness?
A couple of hours, yeah. The first part of it was pretty benign, but then when I got further into it, it did start to get a bit ropey. The orange markers were more difficult to see. It was a little more difficult underfoot, and I knew it was a long and steady climb, but it kept climbing. And I thought, I was starting to get a bit worried about that.
Darkness came, bringing with it a bitter cold.
It was pretty icy underfoot.
John started slipping off the track more than once.
And then I started losing equipment as well. Through some of those falls, I lost a map.
He was scratched and bruised, but John kept going towards the hut. It was 6 hours back to the car park.
I kept walking through the night because the onset of cold, and that I knew from some previous knowledge that I had to try and not succumb to hypothermia. It was just that cold.
Then, in the early hours of Saturday morning, At about 4:30 a.m, in pitch darkness, John Tame fell off a bluff.
Falling through blackness, and then suddenly you land on your feet and there's quite a shock through your spinal system. If I can't move my toes, I'm in a lot of trouble here.
Injured, lost, alone.
Were you worried about what the family was thinking?
I was, but I think I was more overcome with the fact that I've got to get out of here.
Remember, John's wife, Linda, was away in Auckland on business.
No one will know I'm missing because it's still the first night, right? Even if I wanted to, in my lucid kind of way, no one's going to find me. I'm in a thick bush here in the middle of the night.
It would have been minus 10, minus 15 easy. Very, very cold.
Dave Colville of Nelson Police Search and Rescue.
Time can be very, very important. Yep, very important.
Can time be a matter of life and death?
Yes, definitely.
Daybreak was still an hour away.
Did you think I'm in trouble here?
Yes, I did, but I thought I was in. It was retrievable, particularly because the passage of time wasn't great, that people wouldn't or shouldn't be panicking for me, and that if I kept my head, I'd get out of here.
When day finally broke, John had been out in the Kahurangi National Park for nearly 20 hours.
Could you keep warm?
I could do the best with the gear that I had, but no, there's no real shelter and, you're open to the elements, largely.
He'd had no sleep, no food, and was badly injured.
After that serious fall that I had onto my back, things got progressively more difficult. And certainly the next day, it was obvious because I was having falls, I was so much less stable.
John had landed in a deep valley, but what he saw next gave him real hope.
I could see the army moving down the track, which I found strange. Then I saw a tramping party, or I thought it might have been a school tramping party.
And as the day went on, he saw more.
I saw people. I saw a woman with two children. I saw what appeared to be a farmer moving stock from a lifestyle block.
And more, clear as day.
I saw cars and I saw people that appeared to be picnicking down in that area.
There was only one thing. None of it was real.
He was actually hallucinating, probably due to the hypothermia.
Steve Ward is an intensive care paramedic with St John in Nelson.
He was getting to the point where he wasn't going to be making good decisions anymore.
Which is why John hadn't set off his locator beacon.
So I thought that this is all good, you know. Once I can get across the river, I can walk out of here.
Trapper John Tame has been lost in Kahurangi National Park for a day. He's had no sleep or food and has severe injuries.
I was so weak in the legs. I remember I just went smack my head and I could feel the blood coming across my face and unable to move because my back was pinning me down.
His cell phone's not working, but he has a locator beacon. And he's still seeing things that aren't there.
I'd seen two teenagers run down the hillside like phantoms and shouted, sorry to bother you kids, can you just reassure me that if I walk across the river in the morning, I can get to the car park? No answer.
As people become more hypothermic and they get colder and colder, they start doing very irrational things.
Intensive care paramedic Steve Ward says this is a danger sign.
He's going into organ failure and he starts getting some toxins and stuff building up in his system, which kind of interfere with normal brain functions.
Remember, John's wife, Linda, is half a world away in Auckland.
I started to get a little bit worried because I thought I would have heard something along the way. When I met Jack from Mill, I was really concerned.
And Jack is?
My son Jack, yeah.
Jack's, well, this is Jack, one of our colleagues at TVNZ.
I'm Jack Tame. I'm 34 years old, and my dad went missing in the bush.
Jack met his mum in a restaurant on Queen Street, and they attempted to have dinner.
Tried making small talk for 10 or 15 minutes. We were both starting to get really concerned about where Dad was.
It was complete blackness and cold. There is nothing else, and you are alone.
As the rest of the country was settling into their Saturday night to watch the All Blacks versus Tonga game, Jack Tame was trying to work out how to find his dad, if he was still alive.
I got a phone call from an unknown number. It was Dave at the police.
He was almost apologetic for kind of taking up my time.
And he said, right, I hear your dad's missing. What can you tell me?
On duty for police search and rescue, Dave told Jack to send him all of his dad's details.
I think I just focused on getting a photo of Dad, listing all of the items that he had in his pack. Just trying to be in control of those little elements.
At 10:45 p.m, John Tame is officially reported as missing by the police. Searchers would head off to Boulder Lake Hut on Sunday morning.
Were you realistic to Jack about his dad's chances out there?
No, I never mentioned his chances. The fact that he was on his own and that it's so far to get to that hut was a reason for concern.
Back in her Auckland hotel room, Linda rang her sister, a doctor.
We could talk realistically about what the chances were, and that was useful for me, I think.
And those chances were good or bad?
Not good. Not good, being out in the open. Yeah.
Sunday, after the longest of long nights.
I checked my phone for about the 10,000th time. No new messages, and I thought I've got to go to work and do my show.
John Tame woke up to a frightening realisation.
I could see there was absolutely nothing. No car parks, nothing.
None of the hallucinations were real. His actual reality set in fast.
I was almost on all fours. My knees had packed up. As I said to myself, JT, you're in a lot of trouble.
By 9 a.m, Dave Colville was airborne and on his way to the end of the track, so Boulder Creek Hut.
Boulder Lake, we'll land at the hut. We'll go and see if there's anyone there.
At exactly the same time, Jack was in the studio at TVNZ and starting to present Q&A.
Tēnā koutou, no mai, haere mai, welcome. Strangely, the stresses of live telly were a relief compared to the rest of the stress I was experiencing. And so, somewhat unprofessionally, I had my phone in the studio, and in between interviews and in the ad breaks, I was just constantly checking my phone.
That is very dense bush down there. Yeah. Off track, very rugged. Tiger country. Tiger, yes, definitely.
Dave arrived at Boulder Lake while Jack was still on air. He quickly checked the hut.
We just landed at Boulder Lake Hut. John's not here. He hasn't signed in the hut book.
It wasn't good news.
It's the oh shit moment. Yeah, it's. We thought he was here. Oh shit. He hasn't been here. It was really, really cold and things just got serious.
Been missing for 2 days in the freezing cold in the middle of winter by himself. I thought it is more likely that he's dead than alive.
John was badly injured, but he had a moment of clarity.
So here's the thing that saved your life, the beacon.
Worth its weight.
His $20 rental locator beacon was primed and ready to go.
I thought I'd have to let the beacon off just to let someone know I'm alive, even if they can't get to me. So I spread the high-vis jacket vest and my PVC raincoat across these large boulders in the river. So I was as prepared as I could be before I pressed the button.
An alert signal went quickly to Canberra and was relayed back to New Zealand's Rescue Coordination Centre. A search and rescue mission by Nelson Marlborough Rescue Helicopter was underway.
There was an advancing weather front that were coming in that kind of made things a little bit more urgent.
Dave texted Jack.
I thought, that's him.
Within 40 minutes of John setting off the beacon, the Nelson Marlborough rescue chopper found him.
Okay, Cliscuits. Target sighted.
Where he was tucked up was sort of under some tree canopy in the creek bed.
I had no energy. My back was causing me quite a few issues. I had numerous lacerations and abrasions.
Fellow paramedic Jeff Hughes winched Steve down to pick him up.
He had a little bit of difficulty transitioning into the machine himself. He was pretty fatigued at that point. The first thing he said was, you know, just basically a thank you and glad you guys are out here and, you know, sort of a sorry to be a bother kind of thing, so.
I don't think I could have stood another night out there if I was realistic. Yeah.
John had hypothermia, a fractured vertebrae, and widespread muscle wastage. His kidney and liver functions were at 20%.
Because of the situation he was in, he probably would have died that night.
What did you say to him when you first saw him?
Oh, I think I love you.
John Tame's life was saved by a dedicated and highly skilled team of rescuers.
Steve, Ewan, Jeff, I mean, you know, I'll never forget them. I'm sure they've forgotten me already.
They haven't. They also very rarely get to re-meet the people whose lives they saved.
G'day, hey, Steve.
Hey, John, how are you?
Oh, I'm a lot better now, thanks to you guys.
Looking good, looking well. Hey?
Steve pulled him out, but the locator beacon is also a hero of this story.
Had you not set it off, probably a few more hours and we wouldn't have found you. Nobody would have found you in that spot. No, wouldn't have been looking for you where you were. You
know, luck is probably an understatement, so yeah, and I'm pretty grateful, that's for sure.
Physically, John will heal. Making amends to his family will take longer.
You hurt the ones you love, don't you?
Do you think you did that?
Of course. And what's happened's happened, and you know, life has to go on, so. But, and you can't turn the clock back. But yeah, for sure.
It's highly unlikely John Tame will ever go tramping on his own again. But will he ever get to Boulder Lake Hut?
I'd like to think that we can hike up there together. You will not be tramping solo.
Ever again.
Never again. Never again. He's lucky if he's allowed to go to the Foursquare by himself.
And the latest from John is that he's still suffering from back pain, but is getting better every day. Meanwhile, walking and tramping adventures just became a whole lot safer with a brand new trip planning app called Plan My Walk. It's just been launched by the Mountain Safety Council with police support. It's free and includes over 1,000 tracks with live alert information. We've got more on our Facebook page.